possible, the two defendants entered the store, picked 22 specific items off of the shelves, had the clerk take money, make change, then leave. Then two different men drive up in a similar... Don't shake your head. I'm not done yet. Wait till you hear the whole thing so you can understand this now. Two different men drive up in a similar-looking car, go in, shoot the clerk, rob him, and then leave?
No. They didn't have enough time.
Well, how much time was they in the store?
5 minutes.
5 minutes? Are you sure? Did you look at your watch?
No.
Oh, I'm sorry. You testified earlier that the boys went into the store and you had just begun to make breakfast. You were just ready to eat and you heard a gunshot. That's right, I'm sorry. So obviously it takes you 5 minutes to make breakfast.
That's right.
Right, so you knew that. Do you remember what you had?
Eggs and grits.
So Joe Pesci is being a little bit argumentative here, but what he's doing is he is setting a factual and logical trap for the witness to show that the witness doesn't have the kind of veracity or truthfulness that would be necessary to convict for beyond a reasonable doubt. If you can show that a witness is lying or can't be trusted on one thing, members of the jury are far less likely to believe them on most of the rest of their testimony. That can be really, really important for disproving the testimony of an eyewitness.
Instinct grits?
No self-respecting southerner uses instinct grits. I take pride in my grits.
So, Mr. Tipton, how could it take you 5 minutes to cook your grits when it takes the entire grit-eating world 20 minutes?
So, it's a great question because there's no good answer for the witness.
What are these pictures of?
My house and stuff.
House and stuff. And what is this brown stuff on the windows?
Dirt.
Dirt? What is this rusty, dusty, dirty-looking thing over your window?
It's a screen.
A screen. It's a screen. And what are these really big things right in the middle of your view from the window of your kitchen to the sack of suds? What do we call these big things?
Trees?
I absolutely love what Joe Pesci is doing right here. He is using effectively incontrovertible evidence. No one's going to dispute what these things are in the photos, but he is walking the witness down a logical path that he's not going to be able to get out of, which is that there's a lot of stuff between his vantage point and the events that he is an eyewitness to. This is one of the reasons why direct evidence through eyewitness testimony can be actually very, very unreliable.
You could positively identify the defendants for a moment of 2 seconds, looking through this dirty window, this crud-covered screen, these trees with all these leaves on them, and I don't know how many bushes.
Like 5.
Don't forget this one and this one.
7 bushes.
7 bushes. So, what do you think? Is it possible you just saw 2 guys in a green convertible and not necessarily these 2 particular guys?
Well, I suppose.
And what you see here is that the answer that the witness provides, it doesn't matter. The witness here can agree or the witness cannot agree. But the sign of a good cross is that you don't actually care what the witness is going to say. In fact, if he had said that it was a perfect identification, he would have lost credibility based on all of the things that Joe Pesci just talked about here. So that is the sign of a masterful cross-examination. I would recommend all lawyers watch this particular cross-examination of this witness. It's the best so far in court.
There is no way that these tire marks were made by a 64 Buick Skylark. These marks were made by a 1963 Pontiac Tempest.
Objection, Your Honor. Can we clarify to the court whether the witness is stating opinion or fact?
This is your opinion?
It's a fact.
I find it...
It's actually opinion.
...that this kind of information could be ascertained simply by looking at a picture.
Would you like me to explain?
I would love to hear this.
The car that made these 2 equal-length tire marks had positive traction. Can't make those marks without positive traction, which was not available on the 64 Buick Skylark.
And why not? What is positraction?
It's a limited slip differential which distributes power equally to both the right and left tires. The 64 Skylark had a regular differential, which anyone who's been stuck in the mud in Alabama knows. You step on the gas, one tire spins, the other tire does nothing.
So good. There, you want all eyes on the witness, and all you're doing is asking questions that allow the witness to expand, and you're softly guiding where you want the witness to go. Joe Pesci's questions are fantastic. Essentially, what happened next? Or can you explain why that is? What is that technical term that you just used? He's using great open-ended questions. He's not leading her anywhere. And he is letting the witness be the star.
Now, in the 60s, there were only two other cars made in America that had positive traction and independent rear suspension and enough power to make these marks. One was the Corvette, which could never be confused with the Buick Skylark. The other had the same body length, height, width, weight, wheelbase, and wheel track as the 64 Skylark, and that was the 1963 Pontiac Tempest.
And because both cars were made by GM, were both cars available in metallic mint green paint?
They were.
Thank you, Ms. Vito.
Boom! Lawyer.